Angela in Columbus, Ohio, and St. Gabriel Radio in Columbus. Hello, Angela. You're on the air. Angela, going twice.
Yes.
Yes. Welcome aboard.
Great. It's wonderful to finally get to speak with you, and you're the reason why I'm in RCIA classes and have been for several months.
Glory be to God. Excellent. So you're in the faith? Are you baptized, confirmed, full member, or what?
No, I'm still in the classes phase. I'm not confirmed yet. I'm not baptized in the church yet. I'm just in the classes now, and I understand that the next step is the confirmation, the baptism.
Well, bless you, good God.
We need all the sinners we can get, Angela. great to hear from you.
Welcome aboard.
Thank you. What's on your mind? How can Karlo help
what's
you?
What's on my mind? It's kind of been bothering me a bit. For Protestants, they may have sinned in ignorance. Maybe they're a student in the RCIA, or maybe they're just a Protestant visiting a Catholic church.
Yep.
And they take communion, mm-hmm. not realizing that it's a sin by the doctrine of the Catholic Church. Now, how would that be addressed? How would that be addressed as a sin or a resolution for that sin? And how, if I'm evangelizing, because I know it's a point of contention for some Protestants, how can you put that in a positive light?
The million-dollar question again. These are high-quality questions.
Amen, yeah. Patrick. Great question, Angela. So here's what we have to distinguish first, right off the bat. Let me try to put this in a way that we can understand it here. There's a difference between what is objectively wrong, that is to say, something that is wrong in and of itself, like independent of what you think or what I think, it's wrong. It's a wrong action to perform. And then there's another dimension, it's called the subjective dimension, and that has to do like with our culpability. In other words, our accountability for a particular sin. So in the case of, let's say, a Protestant who maybe goes to a Catholic wedding, or, you know, since we were talking about weddings a while ago, mm-hmm. and is not aware of the church's teaching about receiving our Lord in Holy Communion when you're not Catholic, and they go up and they receive our Lord, etc. Now, that action, independent of what he thinks, he or she thinks, or what I think, that's a wrong action. We're not to partake of Holy Communion unless we're baptized Catholics, okay? But at the same time, whether or not that person will be held accountable, only God can judge the heart and the knowledge of that individual, okay? So we have to distinguish between sin, what is sin in and of itself, and the culpability or the accountability of the sinner or the person performing the sinful action. All right, so that's first. Now, secondly, when we're addressing this situation of receiving Holy Communion and not being Catholic, you know what helped for me, Angela, was when we look at the Old Testament, is to look at the new in light of the old. When we look at the Old Testament, we see that God instituted the Passover meal, right? Where you are to partake of the flesh of the lamb. And God instructed that only those who are full members of the covenantal people of God, right? Only those who are circumcised, the Israelites, are permitted to partake of the flesh of the lamb. Whereas the non-Israelites, the Gentiles, the nations, although they could go to the temple and worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they couldn't partake of that family meal, of that sacrificial meal, the Passover. And because the Eucharist in the New Testament is the fulfillment of the Old Testament Passover, because Jesus would say himself, John the Baptist would say of Jesus that he is the Lamb of God, and then Jesus at the Last Supper within the context of the Passover would institute the Eucharist as the new Passover meal, saying, this is my body, mm-hmm. take and eat, this is my blood for the forgiveness of sins, etc. So since the Eucharist is the new Passover, the same principle applies. That is, those who are not full members, right? Those who are not full members of the Catholic Church are not allowed to partake of this new Passover meal, the flesh of the true Lamb, Jesus Christ. But at the same time, those who are not full members are invited. You see, that's key, Angela. We have to always stress that the invitation is always there to invite one to become a full member of the Catholic Church, mm-hmm. in order that they can partake of the flesh of the Lamb of God and experience the fullness of grace and salvation that he has to offer us in Holy Communion.
Paul's pointed warning comes in 1 Corinthians 11, right?
That's right.
Those sobering words. Some of you have sick and others have died.
Yeah. Angela, you know what Patrick is referring to here is in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. If you check this out, verses 27 to right about 29 or 30, St. Paul says that there are some in the Corinth church who are partaking of the bread and wine, eating and drinking unworthily in an unworthy manner. And he says they're eating and drinking damnation to themselves. Yeah. So in light of the revelation of Christ through St. Paul and the inspired word of God, we know we have to be worthy as we partake of the Holy Eucharist in order to attain salvation.
Angela, thanks for the call.